afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Manor Academy. We're going to take some things out of order on the agenda. The only constant is change. I'm going to have Lisa come up and introduce Dr. Francisco Brizuela. He's going to talk to you just for a few minutes.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's good to see everyone. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Thank you. Okay. As you all know, I've been working with the military and U.S. Southcom and the U.S. Garrison. Did I say that correctly, Mr. Brizuela? Where did you say that? I did. Okay, perfect. And what happens is that the military families, if you aren't familiar with what happens, they get moved around a lot. So a lot of times when the students are moving to an area, their parents will contact Dr. Brizuela, right? And then he will contact me and say, listen, we have a lovely family coming to the area. Do you have any schools where we could place our new families? At that point then, we'll come up with a game plan as to which area would be the easiest for them to drop their kids off at school. And then I'll then contact the school, usually the principal or the registrar if I have a working relationship with your registrar, to help place the kids in one of your schools. We have an excellent relationship with them. We have just about, at one point I know, 100% placement rate. So congratulations to all of you and thank you all for assisting me in placing them. I know sometimes you guys are filled to capacity. If you could just email me back and let me know we are filled, but we will put that family on the list. So we are in the process of putting together a memorandum of understanding so that our military families can have preferential treatments when it comes to the list that we have, the waiting list for our families. So right now I would like to go ahead and introduce Dr. Francisco Brizuela. He is a school support service school liaison officer for United States Army Garrison, which is Southcom, that's in Doral. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Once again, my name is Francisco Brizuela. I'm the school liaison officer at the United States Army Garrison in Miami. We serve the United States Southern Command, and we also serve every single and any single installation in South Florida, between the Broward County, Dade County, and Monroe County. Basically, my function is to be the liaison between the families and the schools. And I want to start by thanking you, because in the last 2 years that I've been working as a liaison officer, we have had 100% placement rate with your schools. Just to let you know, I do a lot of statistical studies about the schools in Dade County and Broward counties, and you are way up, you know, and everybody knows that. So that's why when I get calls from Germany, Japan, Afghanistan, formerly Iraq also, our servicemen call me and tell me, please, Dr. Brizuela, we want to go to Doral Academy, we want to go to Somerset Academy or any other school in North Academica. You are in high demand, not only because your name is very prestigious, but also the services that you provide. And also, you really take the extra steps for military families. In the last 2 years, I have seen a lot of cases of families being broken by a death of the family, the military member doesn't come back or comes back hurt. And those are very difficult times for their dependents. And my job is basically to make sure to ease the transition process. And even though we don't have a memorandum of agreement yet, I met with a few of your principals, and all of you have told me, Francisco, we do honor our military. So it is something that is not written in stone, but it's already practiced, which is a sign of best practices from the schools, and also that you really care for our military. On behalf of our four-star general, John Kelly, and our commander, Ms. Mignon Moore, I want to thank you so much for what you do for our military families. Every time I pick up the phone and I call you principals, assistant principals, registrars, I get so much wonderful feedback and support from you. And on the other hand, not only I'm here to support my families, but also to help you. If you have a military family or somebody who comes to your schools and claims to be a family who are military, and you don't know whether they are families that are eligible or not, I can help you with the clearance. I have the power to ask them for a copy of the military card, which is something that I have here, wearing. And in the military card, it has to say active duty. The agreement that we have with both counties is that they have to be active duty in order to get military preference. Okay, they go on the waiting list as anybody else, but they get some type of preferential treatment when it comes to placement. So I'm the one who has the right to tell him, show me your military card, show me your military orders. You can ask for military orders, however, the military orders might not be up to date, but the cop card, which is the government card, is always up to date. And it is a federal felony to falsify the military card. So you will see if they're accurate or not. So they are not legally allowed to show you or give you a copy of the card, but I can do that. So if you have any problems with a military family, you let me know and I'll run them through and I will let you know, yes, it is a yes or a no. Okay? Basically, over the last couple of years, we have placed almost 50 children. These are the children that I know of. These are families who come to me and tell me that, well, please help me when enrollment. But I know that there are many more military families who go to Doral Academies and also San Jose Academies and that I don't know of because they don't directly, they go directly to you. Thank you very much. And of course, I have given somebody, Christine, I believe, yes, a copy of my business card, so you can call me anytime you have any questions. If you'd like me to come and talk to the family on the school, I can do that. And I also go to IEPs as needed. You know, many of our families don't know that the state of Florida mandates an IEP to complete it within 60 days of school. You know, they don't know that, and sometimes it's easy for me to tell them, listen, this is what your obligation is. You have to fulfill this part of the job so that the school can do the job as well. Okay? Any questions?
Can you explain some about the distribution list that you can also, if we do have openings at our school, that you can
distribute that? Yes, actually, I have a distribution list, and I have, right now, I have close to 1,800 families enrolling in my distribution list. If you need advertisement, count on me. I already have a link on my website of your schools. They know where to go. If you have opening in certain grade levels, you can send me an email and tell me, you know, Francisco, I have 5 openings in third grade. I'll fill them up for you if you need the students, you know. So, and also, at the same token, I do meet with the parents a lot, at least once every 3 months. We provide them workshops on IEPs, how to evaluate the system, and that I keep in constant communication with the parents. Okay? Anybody else? Any other questions? Thank you very much, and God bless all of you.
There are some presentation folders on the back and his business card as well. And now our next speaker is someone who needs no introduction. Victor Barroso has a few announcements that he'd like to share with you, and he's also going to introduce our next speaker. And like I said, we're a little bit out of turn on the agenda, but we're going to cover all the items, just maybe something first rather than second. There's a sign-in sheet at the back. If you haven't signed in, you can raise your hand and I'll bring that to you.
Okay. Real quick, we're going out of order for a couple reasons, and I got good news and a favor. The good news is, we initially thought that the virtual presentation was going to be like an hour and a half long at the end. That's not the case. It's about 20 minutes, so you're going to be getting out early. So it's good for you. What's good for me is you want to look at this first, if you don't mind. We have a 20-minute presentation on the very exciting things that's happening in Tallahassee when it comes to virtual education, and it impacts everyone in this room in a very, very, very positive way. Your attention will be great. I think Doug and Danny will be presenting. So give me your attention, that would be great. Thank you for taking us out of there.
Thanks, good afternoon. There are a couple of things that are happening with the legislature right now in Florida, and pardon me for those elementary principals in here, this may bore you to death for 20 minutes, but eventually could certainly impact you as well. So we want to talk a little bit about the changes that are coming in virtual, because it's going to have a significant impact the way we do business with our schools. So let me kind of, Maribel, if you could bring up currently what the legislation says about virtual. And if you've been engaged with Somerset Virtual Academy or Matter Virtual Academy, you know some of this already. But currently, the way the law is written, the only people that can collect direct FTE from the state for offering virtual programs is Florida Virtual School. Nobody else in the state is authorized to do that. And we'll talk about what happens. They also, if you remember, the biggest issue we had with Somerset Virtual was actually the coding of courses. How do we get the teacher coded to teach the course if the teacher is in Jacksonville with a Florida certificate, but teaching a student in Miami-Dade or Broward? That was a big issue. We actually physically had to go hire teachers in different counties to get them an employee number and get them authorization to teach the course, and that was extremely difficult.
Curry.
That's a proposed change. Is that cool? Let's bring that one out. No, that's not the one we want. Just current legislation. Well, anyway, I know it while she brings it up. So basically what's happening right now is, because of the approach and the way the law is written, Somerset Virtual Academy, that is an approved provider, when I say VIP, I'm talking about a virtual instructional provider that is approved by the state to offer virtual education to students. Right now, FLVS, believe it or not, if you did a Florida virtual lab at your school this year, a learning lab, that means you had the additional period. You had six periods plus an additional period. They collected in the neighborhood of about $650 per student. That money didn't come out of your budget. It was free to you as long as you had the additional period. So they were collecting about $650. What happened at the end of this school year, when the state got the bill from Florida Virtual School for the literally tens of thousands and thousands of students that are engaged, they had sticker shock. There was a massive outpouring of, oh my God, we're spending all this money on virtual education. What's going to lead me to the change? Also, the way the law is written currently, the district, Miami-Dade, Broward, Duval, decides who the virtual instruction provider is going to be for the district. And because they hire and choose the provider, they are the only ones that can authorize the coding, the FTE, etc. So that's currently what's going on. The other thing that's happening, we'll come back to this one in a few minutes, is that in order, and we're going to talk about matter in a few minutes, in order to become a virtual instruction provider the way the law is currently written, you have to show experience teaching virtual. Well, how do you get that, right? And you have to show that you've been able to demonstrate some type of learning gains in order to be able to show the state that you have the ability to teach a virtual course and show them. So Somerset did that. We'll talk about towards the end how that happened. We'll talk about some specifics so we don't belabor this. But Matter is in the current, so currently we have Matter who's applying to be an approved virtual instruction provider. Now how does Matter get that? And we'll come back to that in a few minutes. We still have the virtual graduation requirement that went into effect with the digital learning bill last year. So all ninth graders or all high school students have to take at least one virtual course in order to be able to meet the graduation requirement. And then we have this whole new piece of legislation that's happening. We have the first virtual charter school that is actually going to open this year. Matter Virtual Charter School. This is a fully virtual charter school that will open in the fall. Is Frank here? Frankie Menez? Frank will talk briefly about that in a few minutes as to what's happening. They are the only charter school that we have approved at this moment right now to offer a fully virtual education. So what's going to change and what's the impact now on us? You go to the next slide. So why are we having this conversation, if that's all? Well, here's what's happening. Next Tuesday, there is a bill that is going to come up for review in the Florida legislature. The first part has already passed, which will dramatically alter what happens. So what happens? What they're looking at currently is, how do we go ahead and allow the Somerset Virtual or any other VIP, virtual instruction provider approved by the state, to directly collect FTE from the state for offering the courses? There's only about, I think it's four virtual instruction providers that are approved to collect FTE or to offer courses in the state of Florida, and Somerset is one of them. So what does that mean? That means if you have your Florida Virtual Learning Lab this past year, and you offered the seventh period, if you use Somerset, instead of that money going to FLVS, it now goes directly to Somerset. They will have a method to be able to collect the FTE directly from the state, should the law pass, and we think it will, Tuesday as it goes through committee. So what happens now? That money, because they have sticker shock, is going to be down to about $350 per student. From $650, the legislature is only going to pay about $350 per student. Per student per year for FTE. Yes. One course. So what does that mean? So
if 1 year.
1 year. That's all you'll collect.
You'll say
What happens is this. What we will be able to do is not only collect the money directly from them, we're looking at a way to actually do a give back to the schools. So what FLBS does is they take your $650, right? They keep it. Nothing ever comes back to you. But there are ways that we're trying to work after we take the cost out for teaching the course to be able to give a give back to the school. So let's say we were able to pay our costs, do some things, and have $50 a student left over. We could, and you had 500 students, you would net a $25,000 check back to your school. Sound good?
And
of course delivered. And remember, that's based on course completion. So we're looking at ways to be able to do that. You have a survey in front of you, but let's talk about this, the VIPs real quick. Matter is currently in the process of applying. If the new legislation passes, they will allow Matter to get a one-year provisional license without showing experience to be an approved virtual instruction provider, which means Matter schools would be able to go through Matter as a VIP, Somerset schools would be able to go through Somerset as a VIP, Doral, Pinecrest, whichever one they wanted to go through, and the money would stay within the family rather than going to FLBS. The other thing that's going to change in that, when they look at LERC,
are they going to still pay $650
for Florida Virtual School? No. Florida Virtual School is being reduced to $350 as well. So the other thing that's going to change is, if the law passes the way it's currently written, it will allow Matter to show learning gains through their brick-and-mortar schools so that you could present evidence of, this was my learning gain in algebra, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? So what's going to happen? Next Tuesday, this bill is going to go before the legislature. It's going to be reviewed and passed in committee, and it's passed out. There will be a bunch of amendments that will be added. The amendments that will be added that specifically impact us will be the ones that I just mentioned. So here's what we're asking of you, and this is a choice that every principal can make on their own. We can either give the money to FLBS, or we can give the money to our family schools here. And I don't have a... By the way, I don't have a dog in this fight because the Ralph doesn't have a virtual school. So I'm not getting anything other than if I get a give back. So what we're doing is currently, and I'm going to ask Annie to talk about how we're going to set up this program. And currently there are about 1,000 students in Somerset Virtual Academy, give or take some, which people are paying for because they can't collect direct FTE. And we're going to scale this. And when we look at the numbers, we could go from 1,000 students to somewhere between 6,000 and 7,000 in the fall. So you have to be able to have the confidence in us that we can scale it, that we can provide the services, and we want to talk to you very briefly about what we're done. We've reorganized the chart with the organizational chart, we've reorganized the IT support that you're going to get, and all of those things to be able to scale this to deliver a service to you in the fall should you choose to go with us. And there's a survey in front of you that we'll talk very briefly on the end. Danny?
Real quick, are there any questions on the legislation that just on the procedure or how this works?
Why are they passing?
The chances of passing are excellent. Basically, FLBS has lost most of their support in the state legislature.
Lost their competitive edge as well.
Right, and they're looking for now to make it competitive for the purpose of driving down the cost. Right. Let me tell you currently, there is one other thing you should know real quick, and I know Danny will mention this. We're actually developing our own courses. Right now, we buy our content or rent our content from Florida Virtual School. We rent it for about, $100 a student, more or less, give or take. So if we could, we're going to, in the process of discussing with Florida Virtual School, driving that price down so that we can keep more of the FTE. When you add in what the teacher makes, what the cost of the course is, it comes out to be somewhere around $260 per student. But we are actually, the one course that is most used by Somerset Virtual Academy is Spanish 1 and Spanish 2. Over the last 3 months, we have developed a kick butt Spanish course. That's our own course that we don't have to pay to rent from Florida Virtual School. So we would drive that cost to zero plus a couple of platform fees that we would be charged. So all of those things are developed. So let me turn it over to Danny just real quick. Why Somerset?
I'm actually
actually going to try without the microphone. For anyone who knows me, you know that being shy is not my issue. I've always been a bit of a loudmouth, so I'll try it without it, because otherwise you start to see my hand shake. Don't let Doug fool you. He does get something out of this. We don't age him. But I do reimburse him with snuggles after this, so he does get a lot out of this.
And free socks. Can you show your socks, Danny?
They're very professional. I don't know. let me just say this. There's certainly been people at Academica out in front, you know, working with the state to make our case heard when it comes to virtual and changing this legislation and making sure that our schools have an equal right to access these funds to support our students. But the truth of the matter is that the state never, ever would have considered this in the first place if it hadn't been for you. If it hadn't been for all the principals in the room who, amidst dwindling budgets, who amidst continuing pressure to keep those budgets low, took a chance on us and said, yes, we will invest in your program, from Carlos to Bernie, to all of you sitting in this room who helped us get the experience we need to then be able to say to the state, yes, we too can be successful and worthy of that funding. So thank you, all of you. And I want to show off a little bit of what we've been able to do together and what we're going to continue to do to differentiate us from FLBS going forward. But before we start that, let me be a little clear, because you guys know, like being a principal, being an educator has its own language, right? There are all these abbreviations, FCAT, FTE, 504, EOC, like what the heck are you talking about? So let's just be clear about naming in some ways. You might hear a few terms get thrown around. AVE, Academica Virtual Education. That's kind of like the umbrella, very similar to Academica. Handles the management, the oversight, the supervision, the compliance, accreditation, makes sure people get paid, which is not a trivial issue. So they're kind of the management over all of our different virtual schools, but we have a huge network now of schools, from Somerset Virtual Academy to MATA Virtual Academy, being led by Frank Jimenez. And these schools are mostly focused on our domestic students. What does that mean? That means self-paced. That's the traditional student who just wants to take a course on their own. Maybe they're doing it because they've failed a class and need to recover. Maybe it's because they need to accelerate and want to go further. It could be blended. Now, the actual definition of blended would be like more of a Carnegie model, where you have an expert accredited teacher in the room with the students, but every once in a while they might be using supplemental material, online materials, so that they can focus on differentiation for other students in need. But what we're talking about for most of our students, let's be honest, is a virtual learning lab. This is when students are in a computer lab type area, they're logging into their online or virtual classes, they have a facilitator in the room to keep them motivated, to keep them inspired, to keep them on task. But then they are connected virtually through an expert, certified teacher, you know, in a different place, right? So that's what we're talking about when we're talking blended. And let's show off a few of our pictures. All right, so here we have at Carlos Alvarez School. I mean, I don't know if you guys can see this. This is one of my favorite places to go, just because if you ever walk in, all the students stand up and say, good morning, sir, how are you? It's the only time I've ever been called sir in my entire life. They're hard at work, they're always diligent, it's awesome. Next one. Here we have from Pinecrest with Benny Nunez, small group of students. She just wanted specifically to get them in AP, psychology. So she was able to do that for a special group whom she might have lost if she wasn't able to give them the virtual option. Next we have right here at Judy Marty School. Look at all these kids looking all happy to be in a computer lab. Excellent work there. And so that describes what we're doing here. But go back. Thank you. But we also have a few other ones. Doug mentioned MATA Virtual Charter High School, which is actually going to be like a full-time school for kids who want to take virtual. But then in some ways, some of what we do, our most special programs, Somerset Academy International, now in Spain, and beginning our first program in students with Argentina in just a few weeks. Very exciting. Awesome. And then also we have MATA Academy International, which is starting in the fall in Italy. So I know a lot of you are going to be really, really excited to help us start those schools, I'm sure, and visit Verona, Italy with us. So if we can, just show you off a little bit about our dual diploma program. Here's, for an example, a student in Spain talking. She had to do a diary of her life in English. So you can see, you can see it's great. It's like, I usually go up to the roof and have a nice view of all the stars constellation. It's amazing. Again, these are English language learners in high school who are going to graduate not only with their home country's high school diploma, but also with the Florida diploma. And let's go to the next one. Here we are in Pamplona, Spain, visiting some of our students. Look at Cario Summit. So beautiful. Done too, you know. All right, next one. And here we have our first graduating class of our dual diploma program in Spain. And next one. And here's actually me on an iPad giving the commencement address while Andres Calavia, who's our program director, holds it for the students and parents in Spain as we give the commencement address. So that's a dual diploma program. Let's go to the next one. And the reason I mention that is because we are now connecting the students. You're like, okay, that's great for international, but what does it have to do with my kids at my school? And I promise I'm going to pull it together in just one sec. Because now more than ever, we're connecting those worlds, we're connecting those kids across boundaries that traditionally would have kept them apart for their entire lives. So what makes us unique? Experience, academic, the faculty, the vast majority of our teachers come from your schools. They're vetted by you. So instead of just, you know, outsourcing more or less our teaching to, you know, teachers who might be in Tallahassee, teachers in the middle of the state, we have no idea who they are, where they come from. I can get on the line and call Ellie and say, Ellie, what do you know about this teacher? Say, oh, Dan, go ahead, awesome. I love that teacher. All the more reason. If they're not being responsive, hey, what's going on? We can always reach out to the principals as well. What's going on at the school? And have you noticed the same things? There's additional oversight and supervision. And also responsiveness, live sessions. We have teachers right there available for talking, chatting with students. In fact, we have one now, one of Judy Marty's former teachers.
Former.
We're going to bring up in one second. And while we're doing that, we actually have one of our teachers on Skype waiting. But in addition, we also have April McAdangding. April, I'm sorry to embarrass you. Can you come up for one sec? So I want to introduce you to our Teacher of the Year in Academica Virtual from last year. April is also a language arts. So April, I'm sorry to put you on the spot, you know, very quickly. If you can just kind of share your experience as a teacher for Academica Virtual. What makes it special? What makes your experience unique with the kids?
In the beginning, we have, like, it was such a huge challenge to be a virtual instructor. It was my first time. We were just given a survey to answer, and then I didn't know it was such a big opportunity for us. So then when we started the lessons, the turnout of the assignments were very minimal. The students were not responding because it was entirely new to them, and also it was new to me. So we were both in the same boat. They were learning, I was learning the program. So then what we did is to make sure that we develop modules and lessons and incorporate lessons that are significant and relevant to their own experiences. So at first, the material was difficult, and there were a lot of strugglers in my class. So what I did is add lessons. We have this program, we use Brain Honey, and probably some of you have seen the program wherein the teachers are able to tailor fit the lessons based on the students' needs. So during that time, when I started this extra opportunity, the Hunger Games were like the hot seller, the best seller. So what I did is create lessons about those books, and slowly students were becoming engaged or becoming more responsive to the lessons. And also I attributed our success to the fact that everyone is on board, everyone knows what to do, and we have a lab coach, so our lab coach is also proactive. Apart from having the online lessons, we have different technology that we use. Apart from Skype, we have
Adobe. We conduct live tutorial sessions where you get to chat with the students and conduct live lessons. Right now, I couldn't even catch up with my students. Every single day, I have 65 assignments or 100 assignments to check from my students in Orlando and other schools in Academica. So I think this is truly a worthwhile endeavor. As long as we're a team and everyone is on the same page, then we can proceed to achieving high standard and high quality education for our students. It's similar. What I noticed and what I observe is that online learning is the same as the regular classroom learning. We just have to set the pace, set the tone, and set high expectations from the students. And then that's what we will also get. If we as an educator do our role, then our students will also follow suit. That's it. Thank you.
She's one of the most humble people. Let's be honest, she was in a situation, and I'm done with being political at this point, in which her students at the school in Pinecrest, Orlando, if they were an FLVS, they would have been dropped summarily. They were having major issues there. Students who, because of the situation at the school, needed to be in virtual, they would have been dropped. They were struggling, and understandably so. So what did April do? She, as a teacher, totally reinvented the class. On a weekly basis, created her own assignments for these kids to engage them, to meet the objectives, and to get them passing, and completely single-handedly changed the culture there. So April, thank you. And again, just a testimony of the way that Academica Virtual is willing, again, not just to support you, but work with you to really meet the needs of the kids. And similarly, as far as engagement, we want to get kids out of the idea of just walking into a virtual lab, signing in, sitting there being bored. We want them to feel like they're truly part of a global experience. So if you don't mind, I'm going to introduce you to Mari Bel Prieto, who, if you don't know her, you should, and this is going to be the best start. She's going to talk a little bit about our program called Ave Amici and what we have going on at schools like Carlos's, schools like Doug's, and soon schools like Ophelia's.
Good afternoon, everyone. Nice to see you all. Friendly faces. Well, Ave Amici, I've been very, very lucky to be part of this crew. We have Andres Calavia, Gina Lalicata, of course, Doug Rodriguez, Robert Becerra, and the one and only Danny Meyer in this venture. What Ave Amici is more so like a pen pal, but virtually. So we have students that are assigned in Spain to communicate with our students here in the United States. We've had two pilots ongoing now for the last couple months. Doral just had their last meeting yesterday, very successful. They were even doing the Harlem Shake at the very end. And then we have, of course, Cohia, which we have our last meeting tomorrow afternoon, which they just text me, I can't wait to meet my Spain crew tomorrow. So I asked them, so do you guys go on Instagram, Twitter? What are you guys doing to stay in communication? They're using email, they're using PS3, Xbox Live. So these guys are actually connecting outside of Hialeah, outside of Miami. So that's really neat to be part of that. Then we go on to our student peer tutoring. This is more so to have our students engage with our Spain students, cohesively with the domestic students. And what I mean by that is whether it's a project they need help in, language, you know, deficiencies, whatever it may be, we can use our domestic students to help these kids abroad with assignments going on online. Other avenues we've been looking into, such as Edmodo. Edmodo has been a great tool to interact, not only for blogging, but for student badges, kind of like an intrinsic reward without having to give too much blah blah. So then we go on to the one semester exchange program, which that will be hopefully in the fall next year. So we're looking into having some of our Spain kids come over to the USA and experience what it is to go to a United States school here in Miami. And then we go on to AVE now, Autonomy, Mastery, and Purpose. And that's just a little bit more about how we engage and motivate our students. Just, you know, like Danny was saying prior, we don't want them just to walk in a lab, sit down, log in, and just start working on their classes. We want more interaction, whether it be on Edmodo, which a lot of our teachers currently already use this program. So whether it's Edmodo, it's bio activities to get to know each other online, and as well, some Student of the Month activities, Character Ed. I know a lot of the schools currently have Character Ed of the Month. We want to incorporate that into our labs as well. And with that, I need Danny Meyer to content development, which I know Doug brushed up.
Thank you, Maribel. And we know that there's a lot to cover, and we want to be respectful of everyone's time. So very quickly, Doug mentioned before, we're developing our own content. How cool is this, that we're utilizing the experience of all the teachers within Academica who speak Spanish to create our own content. Content that now has videos from students at Doral, speaking audio, it's student made, it's teacher adapted, it's pretty cool. And we also have piloting for you in your school soon, EOC prep guides. In different classes, we're already piloting in biology, in algebra, middle school civics, AP art history, 10th grade language arts, basically to use this technology, even for students not in virtual, to help them as they prepare for these exams. Very quickly and finally, what you're getting from Maribel and our quality assurance team, the constant training and support of your local staff, any issues, any problems, we are there to help on a daily basis, in face. You don't have to call FOVS, you don't have to call up the chain, then they send someone, and maybe 3 weeks later, we will be there as quickly as we can to help you. And we also have a growing help desk, technologically speaking, as far as people to help you with troubleshooting and also moving forward to make sure that a lot of you don't run into the problems you have. So we have people like Michael Smithers, who's our new Director of Instructional Technology, who's worked with Academica IT, who knows your schools inside and out. Sorry, Athena. Who knows your schools inside and out and who can help you to figure out, okay, wow, you need more bandwidth before you can put 700 kids in virtual. You need to make the $10,000 investment, but I promise you it's gonna save a whole lot of hassles down the line. So last step, we're gonna turn it back over to Doug to talk about what we do from here. Guys, thank you so much for all your time.
Thank you, Danny.
Okay, we need two things. How do we make this work? Okay, two things. Remember, we got Somerset Virtual approved as an instructional provider for the state by showing experience. So here's what we need to help Matter. Okay, in order to get Matter approved, in case this law doesn't go through the way, it would be wonderful, wonderful, if you could take maybe two classes in your school of the tested areas, don't freak out yet, okay, like algebra, biology that has an EOC, FCAT reading, one of those courses that you pick, it can be a middle school course, and you use that as virtual. So let me say, you say, are you crazy? How am I going to use that as virtual? Let me tell you what I'm going to do at my school. I was doing Somerset Virtual the last 3 years to get them the experience. I'm going to do two courses for math. But here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to assign one of my Algebra 1 sections next year as a virtual section. However, the teacher who is with those kids, who is in that section, stays with the kids. Because I want to ensure success, and I want to be able to show results so that when Matter applies, if they have to show that they've had experience and learning gains, I have a built-in result with those kids because I need it for my school and Matter. Does it make sense? How you decide to do that is up to you. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do the same thing with an EOC biology next year in high school, assign one section as a virtual. So that's how I'm going to help Matter. If you're interested in doing that, we'll talk about how we do that, but it would be very beneficial, especially our Matter Somerset folks, even if you could do one course, that would be great, so that we can show the test results at the end of the year of students that were in the course and what happened.
One session, not one teacher, so you're talking about it.
Assign one section as the virtual section, let them do the modules, but with the teacher support in the class. classroom and the ancillary stuff of textbooks and other things that you would still use.
They need that experience. That's right. The only way we're going to
okay,
get it.
So what do we need from you? If you have in front of you a survey. You don't have to fill this out now. You're going to get this digitally from Danny in the next few days. Here's what we need to know. We need to have an idea if you're interested in participating in Somerset Virtual next year. Now, if you're a Matter school, when the kid brings up Somerset Virtual Academy, the only banner he's going to see is Matter. So he's not going to know he's taking a Somerset Virtual course. We want your branding. If Pinecrest wants their branding to show when the student opens the course, or Doral, or any of the others, we can create the banner for you. That's not a problem. What will be behind it is Somerset Virtual because they're the improved provider. So we need to know that. Second, we need to have some idea. We've listed the courses in our catalog that we'll be offering next year that are down here at the bottom. We need to know which courses, how many kids, because we need to scale this appropriately so be ready at the first day of school next year. Included within that, we want you to identify a point person at your school that is not the principal or the assistant principal.
Because we know that you're not responding to
that we can say, hey, we're having a problem with the responsiveness of your coach in the lab. We'll CC you on all the emails, but we know that you're so busy that there's no way for you to stop to do all that stuff all the time. We also will require, and this is where Mike will come out, we will do an IT assessment of your building. Why do we want to do that? Because if you decide to put 200 kids a period on virtual, it is going to do something to your network. Okay? There's going to be an impact. So we don't want you to have 200 kids on virtual and all of a sudden everything else stops in your school because you don't have enough bandwidth to be able to do this. So Michael will come out and say what is realistic. He'll work with your IT guy. We also want you to give us your IT person's information. Who is your IT contact at your school? Who can we call, ask questions about your network, ask questions about your bandwidth, etc. Make sense? On the bottom, last thing. There are certain types of courses that are listed here. And you'll see some asterisks next to courses. Obviously, some are semester courses, some are annual. But the other thing you're going to see here that Frank has been working with is we have course recovery courses. Some of these courses can be recovery courses for your students. Some of you have already been doing it. So if you have students that you need to recover a course because they're not going to graduate, some of that is available. What's the difference between that and a regular course? Last thing. Student takes a test. He knows 60% of the course already. He's proficient. He doesn't have to do that 60% of the course. He can do the 40%, and that student will be able to finish that course much quicker, get you to graduation, get you to the end. Frank is our expert in that, so Frank will speak to you about that. And last but not least, let me make my pitch for Frank. He's opening Matter Virtual Charter. Frank, I don't know if you want to say a couple of words. We need to recruit 30 to 50 students who are highly likely to be successful taking the FCAT, taking EOCs. Frank,
can we say an amen to Brother Doug and Brother Daniel?
Yeah. Right.
You know, their sermon's been pretty good,
Real quick, any questions for Doug, though, before Frank starts? On pretty straightforward, right?
And please email us. I've been drafted into the world of virtual now, so it's one of the other things I'm doing. But please email us and let us know, and we'll answer. We'll go to your school personally, sit with you, talk with you, whatever you need.
What we're doing with Matter Virtual is actually a couple of things. When they were speaking about the EOC credit recoveries, we have very viable EOC credit recoveries offered for algebra, biology, and geometry. We're actually trialing the biology and the geometry right now over at Matter Lakes. And the approach that we took was, these were students that at the middle of the year, in January, they were failing the course with a D or an F. Now, what our data showed from our campus last year was any student that had a D or an F by the end of the year, that guy or that girl was not passing the EOC. It was about a 95% correlation between the teacher's grades and the outcomes of the EOC. So with that in mind, we were thinking proactively, what can we do to prevent this, while at the same time developing viable options that we can implement within our campuses to help us with the EOC passing rates? Because right now, there is no EOC solution out there. Either, you know, you go at it with the teacher and just, you know, data and interim assessment and all that, but in reality, there really isn't much. So this is what we did. We told the kids, look, You're going to be in the EOC credit recovery. You lost an elective. And this is how we're going to do it after the test. If you pass the test and you pass the virtual class, we will go back and we will revisit your first and second 9-week grade. I mean, technically speaking, they did algebra all over again, or they did biology all over again, and they did geometry all over again. So why can't you use it as a course forgiveness course replacement? So that's, you know, kind of like the outside of the box thinking that we're doing with this. Now, with Matter Virtual, it's a full high school. Is it for everybody? No. But we do have situations within our schools, and it's not just the behavior ones, by the way. Because, you know, it's not a, this isn't Mavericks and it's not a North Dade Gardens where we're going to get dumped on. We got to have a series of students that we know can go ahead and produce results on these EOCs, because we need demonstrable results on these EOC exams to say, hey, we're into this. So in order to develop the curriculum and in order to move things forward, this is going to be a straight six. In other words, math, science, social studies, language arts, two electives. 4 years, 24 credits, they graduate. In addition to this, and this is something that I might as well ask for forgiveness instead of permission, because, you know, it's in my nature. Yesterday, we actually went to St. Thomas University, and we spoke to one of the deans at St. Thomas. And they're actually interested in developing a virtual dual enrollment course for these students. Now, this is, again, to serve as an attractive, to bring these higher end students and these higher tier students, and not just, you know, tell them, hey, you're limited into just virtual, whatever's, you know, basically like the course offering through the Florida virtual schools. There's no limitation right now. We're trying to open this up to as many kids and give them those opportunities while at the same time following the guidelines for Bright Futures, Florida Gold Seal Medallion, vocational one, and the Florida Medallion Scholars. So, you know, taking all these things into consideration and looking at all these things, if you have students within your schools, 9th graders, 10th graders, 11th or 12th graders, that you feel could benefit from a virtual setting, I'll give you a for instance. We have a student at our school. The girl is suffering from like some really bad anxiety issues. Like, she cannot be in a social setting. Her psychologist basically is telling her, you cannot be in a physical setting. Girl's smart, brilliant kid, but she can't deal with people. So this would be a great candidate to actually have in our virtual school. And I was actually speaking to the father yesterday, and she's interested. We have another one. The girl swims competitively. Now, the competitive circuit, you know, if you have a kid who's a professional athlete, that kid is constantly practicing, and the practices are on odd hours and all that, which under the traditional setting can actually cause restrictions because of timing. This is the kind of kid that can actually benefit from our kind of setting because it's flexible. You know, it's accessible 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They can do it, except for whatever time areas they have within their classes or whatever. You know, it's pretty much their own schedule. So think about it. Even a kid that just, you know, isn't to school, and the school setting is not their thing, but you feel that they could benefit, please send them our way so that we can go ahead and get them started come August. Because it is a very viable option, and we're going to make it to a point where it can compete with the top tier schools, and as far as course offerings, we want to try to beat them.
Thank you, Frank. Listen, real quick, I got to go, but listen, my last thing, Tuesday is when this law hopefully gets passed. Please help Doug and Danny get this off the ground. Let's not give our money away to FLVS. Let's bring it home. We'll do it more effectively. The schools will get some money back.
If they pass it, can we realistically expect? Because remember how the virtual schools were passed by the legislature, mm-hmm. and then they didn't write the whatever they need to write on the administrative side.
Yeah, we're
realistically expecting to be available.
The time frame is this August, correct?
Yes,
this August.
You know, remember what happened before. They passed the legislature, but then they don't write the rules.
Right. Is this scheduled? The way the legislation is written, it's scheduled to go into effect July 1st. But Judy is right. The rule writing is as important as the legislation. How fast that happens will determine some of this.
If we are going to be available,
right.
In August.
We're hoping for August.
And we'll keep you updated throughout the whole process.
That's what is important, because I personally use it for recovery.
Right.
My recovery is recovery and so far I'm not going to know. But I need to have those kids scheduling up.
Yeah, we're hopeful, but the way they're writing the legislation, we're kind of going to force the school districts and the state to put it on them to have this ready for
opening school. Right, right. It's based on the rule. Normally, the legislature passes, and then they take 6 months before they write the rule.
And you're right.
And you can't use it on the rule.
We'll keep you updated, but in your mindset, we're starting this in August, and like he said, we're going to be going to hopefully 7,000 students from 1,000 schools to get money in their pocket, as well as getting a course delivered that where we own our teachers, where we can optimize teachers, where we can look at them, and it's better every. It's a win-win. Just fill out those forms, please. I got you. That's my problem.
Is it going to be more than two?
I'm going for August, but that's my problem, and I'm going to make sure it happens.
I hope so.
You guys just help me out from the everything else. And elementary school teachers, I'm sorry that I took this out of order. So thank you.
Wait, after you the most.
Okay, next on the agenda, I'm going to bring up Martinez. And I ask that if you have questions, let me bring you the microphone, because we're recording this for those people far and away who work with us who couldn't be present today, and making it available to them as well. So, and your questions might be relevant to them. So raise your hand while she's presenting or after she presents if you have a question so that we can get it recorded.
Hi everyone, good afternoon, thank you for coming. I know you're really excited to go over budgets again. It's more exciting than virtual. I'm gonna try to keep it really, really brief. It's just, I know lately you've been receiving some emails with not only your budget, but your budget to actual, so I just wanted to go over real quick so you understand when you receive these reports, what is it you're looking for. And of course you can call me anytime with any questions. So this is the traditional budget that you're used to seeing, and on this column, these are always your latest budget, which is based on analysis that I basically do, and I look at all of your expenses and I kind of project forward and see if we had originally been under budget or over budget, okay? We do the same thing with the FTE. Every time we receive an FTE report, I just review to make sure that the funding that we're receiving for students isn't less than we had originally budgeted. So the top portion of that, sorry, I'm out of breath, I'm really out of shape, and I walk. The top part of the budget is actually your revenue. So for this specific school, which is the sample budget we're using, obviously they're receiving rates for top in the high school because they're receiving advanced placement. And on the bottom of the budget, you have your projected expenses, which obviously start with your salaries, and then you have other line items. Okay, so I know you're familiar with this format, and this format is the budget for the entire year. Okay, so it's a 12-month budget. So this is the new report. Okay, now this was exported from QuickBooks into Excel, so it looks a little bit different than the one I'm sending you, which is actually scanned from QuickBooks, but it's basically the same exact one. So where you can see on the top is where you have your revenue, just like you would have your revenue on the budget that you're used to typically seeing. The only difference is that when you would receive a budget in the past, you're only looking to see how much we're anticipating your revenue to be, how much we anticipate your expenses to be, but there's never been a tracking for you unless you sit there with your financial statements and actually line it up to your budget to see where you are in your spending. So this report is going to facilitate you with that. The first column, obviously this report runs from July through January, so that's 7 months worth of expenses, okay? The next column is your budget. That's 7 months worth of your budget. So if you were to take the budget that you're used to looking at and you divide it by 12, okay, and then you multiply it by 7, it's every single month, so you're looking at 7 months worth of budget. It's going to tell you where we have budgeted, what you actually either received or spent, and what the variance is. Okay, on your revenue, for example, in this school, we budgeted 6.1 million, but we've only received 5.8. So we have a negative variance on the revenue of 284,000. Is that good? No.
Is it because
am I concerned?
Yeah.
The reason is because for this specific school, capital outlay was not yet distributed. It hadn't been dispersed.
okay? But these are things that I'm looking at.
Well, so that school is going to get it, hopefully, huh?
Yes, they sure are. So, yes, they are. And that's something that we look at. So as far as revenue goes, you don't need to be so concerned because we're looking at that. What you want, what you do want to be vigilant on are the actual expenses. That's what you can control, okay? So for example, over here, let's say we have the salaries. If you notice for this school, the actual is 2.7 million, close to 2.8. What we budgeted was 2.8. So you have a negative variance of 35,000. That's actually good. That means that for the 7 months, we're 35,000 under what we had anticipated. Overall, if you look at the total salaries and benefits, if you, Christine, if you just go down a little bit more. If you see there, you see where it says 109,000. That means that we are 110,000 under salaries and benefits as a whole. You need to make sure that this number, that your actual is always less than the budget. Why? Because this actual is based on July to January. But your July actual is actually your payroll from the prior year. Because remember, you're paying those teachers from July to August 15th, it's going to be your old staff. So you want to make sure that you have a cushion because we do have to, we're going to have to record an accrual. And the accrual is basically for the portions of salaries that are not paid as of June, but that they pertain to that school year. All of your teachers get paid until August 15th. Do you follow me? So you may have additional staff that's not reflected, that wasn't reflected maybe in July or August. There may have been salary increases that are not going to be part of your July and August 2012 payroll, but that they are, it is a reality for your 2012-13 school year. So it's very important that that is always, that this amount is always a little bit higher than what your actual is, okay? Because you need to have a little bit of cushion. For your professional and technical, I broke it out a little bit more. Normally on the budget, it would just say professional and technical. What I've done is I've actually broken it out into management. Here you see the legal, but you don't see that on your budget. It's way too much detail. But on the actual, you'll see what you have it. And you'll see that, for example, this specific school, their actual was 451,000, and what we had budgeted was 531. And that's great. That means that somebody didn't record her management fees. That's all that means. Because the management fees is actually a calculation on your budget. So, but for the most part, I mean, if you look at her miscellaneous, her other, we had budgeted, okay, maybe not. You've overspent on some items. But remember that, that's for example, I even your supplies. No, it's okay, Judy. Remember that there are certain line items where you're going to have more spending in the beginning of the year. For example, your audit, okay? If your audit cost is $20,000, I'm not going to take $20,000 and divide it by 12, and then you're going to track it month to month. We're just going to record the total audit in October, because that's roughly around the time that your invoice is going to come in. Same thing with insurance. Your insurance, you pay it pretty much in July, so you're going to see the budget line item come in July. You're not going to see it prorated, or it's going to show as if you've overspent most of the year. But like if you look at insurance, we budgeted 150, she's at 146, so that's good. Her travel, we budgeted at, so far at 15, she's at 12,000. Repairs and maintenance, she's right where she's supposed to be. Her rent, same thing, communication. So this is just a really good way for you all to be able to track if you guys are on budget. And really, if you have a tight budget, where you can actually reduce cost. So I really hope you guys like this.
The only thing I wanted to say is that professional technical, you have to go to your actual profit and loss, because I saw a huge amount, but there are certain things like when you pay FIU or Miami-Dade, and there is no place to put it. So it's showing on the profit because I got a fit. Last year, I paid like 100,000. What is it? No, it was totally correct, because what by paying dual enrollment, I'm actually saving the teacher. So it's really not a bad deal, but it's learning the different areas is awesome. The profit and loss, if you look at it, it helps.
We would typically send you the profit and loss and also the profit and loss by detail, so you can see under every single line item, like for example supplies, every vendor that's been paid. But there was never, the only way for you to actually track where you were in comparison to what we had budgeted and the board had approved was if you actually sat there and
you pretty much have to memorize your budget. So this way, I think it's just an easier tool for you guys to be able to monitor yourselves. I hope you really enjoy it. It's a little time consuming, but you're all worth it. And you can call me with any questions or concerns. And that's it. Does anybody have a question? Don't be so excited.
There are no questions for Anne. Well, if you don't have a question right now as you get back to your school, if you think of something that you'd like to ask, I can forward the question to Anna and then broadcast her response to everyone, because you may not think of something now, but maybe something will come up later. We were going to have a presentation on account payables. However, the system was down, so we decided to save that for the May 1st meeting.
Anna, do you have anything you want to say about the accounts payable?
It's basically just a new
way.
The accounts payable is a new software system that we basically implemented. And basically, you're going to be approving all of your invoices online. And it's great because that way, if you ever want to track an invoice, everything's just pretty much saved on iCloud. It makes it a lot easier. There's no more scanning, there's no more printing, approving, and sending back. Everything is just kind of sitting there. You're going to approve it. And once we know that it's approved, it automatically goes into our accounting software system. So you'll get an update on that. Hopefully, we'll have that up and running after spring break. So Adam will be presenting on that at the next principal's chat, which I believe is May 1st. There was actually a problem with the Where IT. And on a separate note, which has nothing to do with this, we're actually looking for a different accounting software system. We've met with a software company, and that will provide all of the principals with the ability to log on to their individual school's accounting system and run any report they like, because I know how excited you guys are.
Anna,
a lot of exciting
things. I have a quick question. When you, with the system that Adam's talking about, when you approve... Oh, sorry. My question is, with the system that Adam is talking about, when you approve an amount there, that will automatically go to actuals. Will it read? You said it'll read straight in, so it'll be deducted right off. Okay, so you'll get a live budget all the time. That's awesome. Thank you.
Yes. Well, a live actual.
A live actual, which is, yeah, it's as live as we're going to get the budget. Thank you.
The moment that it's actually scanned into the system, it automatically uploads into QuickBooks. So there is no actual manual entry of that invoice into the accounting software, which at this point, we're currently using QuickBooks. So,
Would it also stop the duplication of invoices?
It should, yes. Yes, because the system is actually going to catch it at the time of scanning. It's going to recognize it. It won't recognize it. I mean, if you put it in the same school like Matter Lakes and Matter Lakes Middle, okay, if you approve it from Matter Lakes High and then you approve it under Matter Lakes Middle, there is no way really of catching them. Those are two different systems. However, the new software system that I'm looking into purchasing, that would catch it, because that is one main database for every single vendor and every single school.
Yeah. Particularly for those schools that are split. We have split.
Right. So, a lot of things coming.
But the new software would subtract it from your middle budget and your high budget, so you should notice that you've approved something twice.
Right.
So we still have the option to tell you split the space.
Absolutely.
All the invoices, for example, we purchase something from Staples or companies that we buy as principals, will the invoice go to the school or to academic?
No, the invoices will continue being received at the academic office, and then we're going to have a data entry person at our office who's going to receive these invoices and scan them into the system.
All the companies that we purchase go directly to Academica? Would it be better that the school gets it, approve?
No, you don't have to approve it. Everything gets approved now online. So before we receive the invoice, it would get scanned and emailed to you. Now what happens, it gets scanned straight into the system, so it's online. And you receive a notification that you have an invoice pending for approval. And once it's approved, then it goes into basically our ready to pay batch.
You know that we had certain invoices that from here. So we, what we do is then scan and send it to you.
You will need to send those to us, absolutely. Yeah. All the courses really need to go directly to Academico. That's how it should be set up.
Anna, so, is it searchable, the database? Can you search for an invoice?
Yeah.
Anna, are we still creating POs then?
You can, yes.
Do we have to?
You do the PO before you get the invoice, not after.
Some of the stuff you don't have to. The companies, you know, if you're ordering something small, we don't create POs.
I guess it depends on the size of your school. But most schools are using a PO because what you place an order for today, you may not remember the refunds when you receive it. Maybe they should do an extra time and you didn't even order that. So that's really the reason why you want to use POs. It's really your own internal check and balance of making sure that what you intended to purchase 3 months prior is actually what you're being invoiced and is actually what
the things that you have every single month, like you're cleaning, you know, it's always the same exact. Should we still
The POs is that the company knows that if you don't sign the PO, they don't sell it. If you have a big school, you can have somebody ordering for you. And if they don't have a PO, that company knows not to buy if there is not a PO. They will not give it to you unless there is a PO number. So POs are for your own protection, not anybody else's. Because you got to control who's buying at your school. Without a PO, you have absolutely no control. The auditor suspected.
Well, she's picking up like a monthly service, like your cleaning service that is a fixed amount.
Isn't that a contract?
As a contract.
It's
a contract.
It's different because it's a contract.
But the supplies that you buy for cleaning are different each month.
And I have one more.
Sure.
I know what the internal account that I have at my rates, the internal account. But in the operational account, which Academica handles, I have no idea if I'm, you know, only when you meet with us and you tell us we're doing good, we're doing bad. But I would like to every month to have an idea of if I.
There you go.
It's going to be right there for us.
It tells you how much you received.
How else are we going to have that?
It's a live budget. It tells you how much you received, how much you received.
I love you.
You can ask for it.
Great. And how often? Well, every month that we close the books, that we reconcile the bank statement. But you know, if you want it at any other time, I mean, you can always send me an email, and of course, we'll be more than happy to. I mean, it's simple. It's just you're just exporting the profit and loss. The thing is that really, if you're seeking it anything prior to every month, would be useless for you. We only enter your payroll. Payroll is done in the form of a journal entry. You're only going to receive that every month.
So as I told you, we're closing the books up. You guys add on December 1st now.
Just a refresher.
The thing, honestly, let's ever remember that we're closing the books and it's during the audit, so like that's going out to every single school to make sure.
At least in the beginning of the year.
Well, we can definitely do it in May, and we can do it again. Like, we can do it in the May, in the chat, and then we can do it in September as well. Yeah, we can do both times. I'll send it, please.
That way you're hired for your professors or whatever.
Yes.
Yes, you know, it could be a refresher and then for the new. Any other questions? Suggestions? Comments?
Thank you, Anna, for everything.
Okay, since Doug and the virtual team were so short, I think I'm going to really be able to get you out of here early. I just have a few announcements. The principal evaluations need to be from last year. I only have a few, so I need a copy of your principal evaluation. I just keep it in a file because it's in your contracts that academic will maintain the copy. So for those of you that are in Dade, that should be the form 7197 and your dashboard IPDP goals, that should be from last year. I need a copy of that signed evaluation. If you need help getting it signed by your board chair, I can help you with that. And then for those of you in Dade County, you should already be working on a mid-year evaluation, especially if you're a race to the top school. Those have to be uploaded. For those of you that are Race to the Top, if you want your Race to the Top money, and if you don't know what I'm talking about, we can talk about it afterwards. For those of you in Broward and other counties, or for those of you watching this video later, each county has a different evaluation tool. Some boards have adopted a different evaluation tool. So you should know what evaluation tool you're being evaluated with annually. If you don't, you can call me, we'll talk about it, and I'll try and help get you an answer. I've received some chat session agenda items. We're gonna split off in a few minutes and have just the secondaries chat for a while and the elementaries, and we'll go over those. But for future meetings, please send me agenda items. I don't publish and say, this question was brought up by so-and-so. I just put it on the agenda. I try and get someone to speak to the item. It's just to help you. If you have a question, your colleagues probably also have the same. And our next principal's chat is going to be May 1st at Somerset City Arts in conjunction with the Technology Fair. So I look forward to seeing all of you there. And then there were some lunch updates, and I listed them out here on the back, exactly what she had written. I really don't want to read them to you, but I want you to look at them very quickly in case you have a question, we can discuss it, and I can get you an answer. Breakfast meal pattern is changing for the incoming school year. A committee will be convened to create some new breakfast menus. NSLP renewals just started, so sponsor contacts will be requesting projected information for the incoming school year to renew sponsorship. When the new year begins, the information can be updated. Grocery bid for self-prep kitchens is underway. And the consortium meeting on Friday the 15th, all vended catered schools are invited to attend if they wish to rebid their food service contract. The consortium is going to organize a catering bid. Auditors will be conducting single audits at INC level from now on. It's imperative that eligibility resulting from verification be correct. There is still time to make corrections. Please confirm all eligibilities in POS, especially for verified students. Auditors will be requesting rosters for October and May. Be sure to have POS rosters on file and save all NSLP paperwork for 5 years. And like I said, if the secondaries would come to this side of the room and the elementaries would go to that. I know there were a few discussion items. For those of you that are K-8, go where you feel it's more appropriate. The only two discussion items that I received for secondary were summer course recovery option for Algebra 1, Geometry and Biology. So I guess there's a discussion item for the secondaries. And the elementary discussion about certified music art and possible PE for elementary schools, even for K and 1. So we can split now. Yes, any announcements or other agenda items?
Since we move super fast through virtual, just one last thing. We're going to send you something closer to the end of the school year. If you have identified who your coaches will be in those labs, we will train them for you prior to the start of the school year on how to register kids, how to make sure that everybody, because the last thing that we want, which is what happened, is that you went days and weren't able to start and it was miserable. We're actually going to hire some college interns that are going to go out and do site visits for you and troubleshoot everything. So just one more thing you get with us if you come with us, but we'll be sending that out. So if you know who those coaches are, and we're also asking that one person you identify as your liaison, that they come. The training will be an hour max somewhere at one of our schools so that they can be trained in case you run into problems on the first day with kids registering for virtual. That's it, I'm done.
And just to give you a date, please send me a copy of your principal evaluation. I don't need APs, I just need the principal evaluation before you go to spring break. Or at least contact me about it from last year.
Well,
yes. Do
you need a mid-year for this year
soon
sent to you, or
no? You don't need to, I only need to collect the annual. Okay. But you need to upload it. So you need to
I always do that.
But I don't want to make you send it to me.
Okay.
So they need to be signed by the board chair?
They need to be signed. Every principal needs to have a signed principal evaluation.
My first principals are going to be signing them tomorrow, so have the mid-year.
Yes, yes, you matter people, yes, I'm collecting those for you.
Okay, do we send it to you?
You can send
it.
You can send me your copy and I'll get it signed for you.
Well, I sent it to you already.
I got it. I'm using it as an example. Other questions?